On July 16th, 1994, comet fragments the size of the Colosseum up to Rome's inner city started showering down onto planet Jupiter. And then, with an energy release of several hundred times the world's nuclear arsenal, the atmosphere was scarred for months, marking the fate of Shoemaker Levy 9. And this brutal event didn't come unexpectedly. 16 months before impact, astronomers confirmed an object about 4 degrees from Jupiter at roughly the same distance from Earth. And what first appeared as a single object turned out to be 21 major fragments moving like a string of pearls. Calculations backward in time showed that 2 years before impact, a larger comet passed Jupiter's Roche limit. That's when Jupiter's gravitational falloff across the comet is strong enough to break it. Yet the attraction force toward Jupiter is so dominant that it visually conceals this falloff across the comet. It's uncovered by splitting into a mean force plus tidal forces, which shows that the back of the comet is not attracted as much toward Jupiter as the front. And when these tidal forces overcome self-gravitation, the comet disintegrates, leaving a string of rubble that gravitationally reassembles into the main fragments. And when all the uncertainty in the calculations settled, the next flyby was determined to be as close as 45,000 kilometers from the planet's center, which is smaller than Jupiter's radius. The impact became a certainty, and this news spread. With everyone anticipating this research opportunity, it became the best observed extraterrestrial collision in our solar system of its time. While the consecutive impacts were out of sight, within a few minutes of each, a plume rose into sunlight visible from the Earth. And within a few hours, dark spots rotated into view. And in less than a week, all fragments hit, erasing them as potential threats to the inner solar system. What made Shoemaker-Levy 9 so intriguing, it not only revealed part of Jupiter's inner chemistry, but how its massive presence shapes comet orbits throughout the solar system. This is Oterma, a similar-sized comet that is still out there. And just like Shoemaker-Levy 9's most probable origin, it was once inside Jupiter's orbit. But unlike Shoemaker-Levy 9, it survived what scientists call a temporary capture, swinging to its current orbit outside of Jupiter's, away from the inner planets. And while both comets never threatened the Earth, scientists began scrutinizing Jupiter's role as the vacuum cleaner of the inner solar system. But they were right, being skeptical. When a giant planet changes comet orbits like it's nothing, what's the chance it works in our favor? And if Jupiter helped, was it about preventing Earth impacts? First things first, Jupiter can be a foe as much as a friend, and comets can swing to an inner orbit, which is exactly what happened to Oterma in 1937. Its then closer distance to the Sun activated it, sublimating comet dust and ice into a nebulous coma, which facilitated its discovery shortly after. And in the future, predicting is tough. Every planet encounter amplifies the prediction uncertainty, and taking a few of these encounters produces vastly different comet orbits. That's why single-path predictions eventually become anecdotal. To see Jupiter's protection qualities, we have to bring in statistics and structure. Imagine a solar system made of the Sun and Jupiter circulating around their gravitational center, which is slightly above the Sun's surface. A small comet, which is attracted to both all the time, draws a path switching between inner and outer orbits. Now, adding more comets of the same energy and it's going to look pretty messy. But now things get twisted. The camera starts rotating to keep the Sun and Jupiter on a line from left to right. This is what you're going to see. First, you see that an elliptic orbit without camera spin looks like a flower shape from the spinning camera. And this is what we are looking for. Right at Jupiter are the major orbit changes, but at the same time, it's the only way in and out, surrounded by what seems to be an energy barrier. You will never find our comet in this forbidden region. And it cannot simply pass through this hole, it must approach inside these gateways called manifolds. Now, these structures change with the comet's energy level, and I will show you where exactly they come from. You can build twisted routes by overlapping them for multiple planets, but for the moment, let's stick with a single planet model. Remember when I said we need structure and statistics? Now we have these structures, let's add a million comets. So we simply pretend they just swung out of the inner solar system, leaving Jupiter's sphere of dominant influence following the exit gateway. This is what you're going to find. Many return at some point, but it can be pretty far into the future. Chances of swinging back in happen only so often, with the first ever return after 23 years. This analysis gives an idea how the outside welcomes objects coming from the inside. And when a comet approaches from the inside following the gateway, it will have a delicate combination of location and velocity values, forming a region embedded in four dimensions, two positions and two velocities. And by cutting along one dimension, a slice of the gateway can be drawn over the other three dimensions. This outer ring is the cut through the manifold, which encircles the comets we just sent out. Now, sending 1 million comets that leave Jupiter toward the inner solar system, we can see both clusters competing over time. And with the shorter orbit period on the inside, there are simply more frequent opportunities to kick comets back out. Eventually, comets are more likely to be found outside. Without Jupiter, the 2 million orbits don't change. So in this setting, Jupiter cleans the inner solar system, which is encouraging, but there is a catch. You don't really need this barrier. This is a height map of the gravitational potential energy, with its slope giving the gravitational pull. This is what a comet sees as it swings around. Looking from the spinning camera, the comet occasionally slows down so much that it comes to rest and turns around. There is a point it won't pass. The collection of all these zero relative velocity points is the barrier. And since these barrier points themselves are fixed in the spinning camera frame, they behave like objects forced onto circular orbits. Now, to force an object onto a circulating orbit, without camera spin, the centripetal force correctly pulls it onto a circle. From the spinning camera, the object must not move, so to balance forces, a fictitious centrifugal force consistent to the camera change must be added. And as for the gravitational force, the centrifugal force is linked to its own potential. Adding both gives an effective potential, forming an intersection line with the comet's total energy level. This line is the zero velocity curve or energy barrier, which changes with the comet's energy. And since the comets live in three dimensions, the energy barrier can be drawn like this, which means any comet coming from above and below must have a higher energy. It's already in the forbidden region for the lower energy comets, so it cannot be subject to this mode of protection. But even for higher energy comets exceeding the barrier, Jupiter can still deflect hazardous inbound comets. Now, we can analyze this in three dimensions, but for what comes next, two dimensions are complex enough. And here's the question. With no barrier on the comet's energy, how much of a friend or foe is Jupiter? think backward. What makes an object Earth-threatening? It's about to closely approach the Earth. And how do you know if it's likely to happen? When its current orbit passes the Earth's orbit at a close distance. Then, at some later time, both objects likely get close. Now, in a chaotic system, a lot can happen until then. But if your current best bet, your best predicted orbit, shows that a massive object is likely to get close, it qualifies as a potentially hazardous object. In two dimensions, getting close mostly means crossing orbits, and you call these objects Earth crossers. And to see a strong pull from Jupiter on these objects, they must pass near Jupiter inside this band. And cutting through it, for each radius, there's a range of path angles and speeds that produces Earth crossers. Now, given that Jupiter can only be at one place at a time, a short-time study shows precisely that. Objects are mostly out of reach. A better question is, given that the objects are within reach, how effectively can Jupiter kick them out of their Earth-crosser orbits? So shooting 10 million Earth-crossers like this makes them form a line that Jupiter punches right through. Most objects remain Earth-crossers, which again reflects Jupiter's limited reach. 350,000 objects aren't Earth-crossers anymore, and among these, 75,000 are ejected from the solar system entirely. That's when, after the swing by, they have a positive specific orbital energy. They escape the system on hyperbolic orbits. This is how Jupiter pulls on objects that are Earth-crossers already. But does it qualify Jupiter as a friend? Because Jupiter can also make objects into Earth-crossers in the first place. And these are found by sending back in time 10 million Earth-crossers to see how Jupiter pushed them on that path. Most of them were Earth-crossers already. Focus on the ones that weren't Earth-crossers before the swing by, that Jupiter made harmful in the first place. Can you see it? Running back in time with Jupiter pushing objects back to where they came from, and running forward with Jupiter pushing objects out, is the same analysis, just flipped in time. That's due to the time reversibility. For every path where Jupiter kicks an object away from the Earth, there is a mirrored anti-path where an object is pulled toward the Earth. Jupiter is neither a friend nor a foe in terms of shooting capabilities. It's about how long it takes for objects to get the next chance to meet Jupiter. And the orbit periods of Earth-crossers are, on average, shorter than the orbit periods of non-Earth-crossers. There are simply many more places to go to. So even without an energy barrier, this makes it more likely for objects to accumulate on non-Earth-crosser orbits, many of those leaving the solar system altogether. Once again, Jupiter cleans the inner solar system. But that's too optimistic. Especially as this is an incomplete playground solar system. Reality is complex, and this mechanism alone, we cannot rely on it, because all along, Jupiter drives another mechanism that is problematic. This is a disk of asteroids inside Jupiter's orbit, safe from its dominant influence. The asteroids are spread evenly and move on elliptic orbits. It looks like a calm, uneventful solar system. But it takes just 20,000 years, which is about 1700 revolutions of Jupiter around the Sun, and some asteroids become Earth-crossers. So even with Jupiter far away, its influence reaches us. And the mechanism driving this is best shown with objects on precisely circular orbits. And now it takes just some hundred years until ring segments form that are everything but spread evenly. That's a blink in the solar system's timeline. And it doesn't take much longer and the next rings appear. With all these gaps forming, we have seen the fate of the asteroids that occupied these spaces. It takes some time, but a lot of them reach us. These gaps are caused by orbital resonances, which make orbits dynamically unstable. I made in-depth videos explaining this uncomfortable truth. These resonances cause a group of objects that harbors many potentially hazardous objects. These are the near-Earth objects. And with their many orbits currently reaching us, they are the most popular impact candidates researchers watch out for. But in our solar system, there are more short-time interactions to watch out for, interactions that keep sending new objects to us. We have seen these objects reaching us from interstellar space and the outmost regions of the solar system. And we have seen how Jupiter changes their orbits in a very short interaction time, making them into Earth crossers. But here, I built a cascade of gateways that enables comets, which get nowhere closer to us than Neptune, to still reach the inner solar system. And for these low-energy trans-Neptunian objects that are mostly blocked behind energy barriers, it needs three mechanisms to reach us. The orbital gateways to swing from an outside orbit to an inside orbit, plus a tricky sequence of orbital resonances that lowers the orbit's distance to the Sun and prepares the comet for the next gateway passage, plus an additional trick. I will show you how exactly the comet must approach the planets to get this going, which also comes with the coding tutorial on how to compute these gateways, if you're into this. Seeing the actual code makes it easier to appreciate the mechanisms, and seeing a passage in detail highlights how the gateways truly work. The gateway manifolds are quite convoluted, making some transitions longer than others. This sequence here is not the fastest orbit alteration, but ultimately, the comet reaches us. And it doesn't even have to take all of these gateways. I will show you even faster ways how these low-energy trans-Neptunian comets become Earth crossers. The solar system dances to the everlasting tune of orbit migration. Astronomers have mapped numerous asteroids and comets that can reach us, and there are even more hazardous objects we don't know about yet. The best we can do is to continue the research and study the motion of our deep space fellows. This allows us to anticipate future impacts, but also to appreciate our past. There are many hypotheses about the solar system's formation, but we are sure that in the early hotter stage, 4.6 billion years ago, volatile molecules like water could only condense and gravitationally accrete outside the frost line, forming the gas and ice giants and icy comets. Inside the frost line, mostly non-volatiles such as metals and silicates accreted to the rocky planets. And everything that didn't accrete in time was blown away by the solar wind. At a later cooler stage, water could exist on Earth, but there was none. To fill our oceans, there had to be a mechanism bringing icy material formed outside the frost line to the Earth. That's why Jupiter and the other giant planets are believed to have an assisting role in sending life-enabling material to us. And if that's true, the question whether Jupiter is a friend or a foe is secondary. Jupiter gives as much as he takes. There will be an impact. But that's part of the deal, because it's not unlikely that without earlier impacts, there wouldn't be enough life-enabling material. There wouldn't be us.